anybody new in sales needs to remember that they have to have self-care and they have to take care of themselves before you can take care of others. And so it's kind of like, just, you know, remember that. Like,
sure.
Try to get your workout in, try to eat lunch, even when you have crazy days.
Nice. And what's that?
I don't miss my workout.
To the Be Better podcast. I'm your host, Kim Haney, and I'm here with my co-host, Donald Kelly. Donald, how are you?
How you doing, Kim? Hey, everyone. Excited to be here with you all today for another amazing episode. Some great content, and you're going to love it.
Yes, exactly. I'm happy to be here, too. It's going to be really great. So, unfortunately, I actually wasn't here for this one, but it's okay. Donald was, and he was able to speak with Nicole and Jamie Hilderbrand. They are both real estate agents, and they are actually married to twins, fun fact, which explains the same last name. And what sets them apart from their competition is their exceptional customer service and what they bring to the table to all of their clients. Donald, tell us a little bit more about them.
Yeah. Well, what I love about this is, like, you know, as we're, you know, many of us are trying to figure out this entrepreneurship thing or trying to develop a business or even just like in the work that we do, like, how can we give better service? And the things that they talked about in this episode, you're going to love it. Like little things like, you know, for holidays, getting little gifts, or, you know, when somebody sign up and become a client, what kind of gifts, how do you wow those individuals? And oftentimes it's not like things to just get people to buy from them, but it's just the fact that they're the sheer kindness of their heart, being willing to just give and help people out. And that's just made their company just like grow so well. And here's the crazy part, because they marry twin brothers, the brothers like are inseparable. So they live right next to each other. It's crazy. So the two families like blend together.
Yeah.
So it was a fun episode.
Before you go ahead and continue to listen, subscribe to the Be Better podcast if you haven't already. If you can't already tell, it's a lot of fun here. You can find us on Google and Spotify and Apple and Stitcher. So go ahead and subscribe, and then let's go ahead and jump right in.
Jamie, Nicole, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us.
We're excited.
We are stoked about this. I think it's going to be some really fun content here. And I bragged about you all in a teaser. And one of the things that we were talking about was your backstory a little bit. And I want to dive into that because you're sister-in-laws.
Yes, we are sister-in-laws.
And your partner, your business partners. And you marry brothers.
Yes.
We married twins.
Twins.
Identical twins.
Yes.
There are a lot of stories in that we need to hear about.
Like, we have two husbands each.
We pretty much always do. And we've never not been neighbors, except for brief times when we were building our first houses. And I've been married 18 years. She's been married 19 years. And the twins pretty much didn't separate until
our
marriage. Yeah, they got married. So yeah, we have always been neighbors.
It's a very different dynamic, for sure.
Well, that's pretty neat. Were you all friends before you met the twins? Or
No. I would not know Nicole if it wasn't for my husband.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, very neat. And let's talk about what you all do right now, because you have a pretty successful career in the real estate game. So let's talk about that. Tell us a little bit more, the audience, so they can get familiar with you.
Do you want to go first?
Sure. So we started Refined Realty Group to represent our husbands. I used to teach high school history and psychology. She used to teach nursing school, and they needed an agent. And we were like, you know, we're going to test. We know your product better than anyone else. We can do this. And so we started. And so we do all of their new construction listings, which keeps us extremely busy.
Busy, yeah. They're spec residential builders. They've been in business 20 years and built in multiple communities around Nebraska. And so we are building right around, I would say, between around 100 houses a year is what they build.
What?
And we're their only listing agents. So we are busy. But it's been a good thing for us.
Yes, it has.
That's amazing. So I think there's a lot in there that we can unpack that would be pretty cool to get. But you all, one of the things that you do really well
is deliver phenomenal service when it comes towards working with the clients. How about you both take a stab at it and give me what's your definition of service and why it's so important to deliver a great service?
First of all, these our price point on our homes are usually, it's probably about second or third time home buyers. So this is one of the largest purchases the clients will make, essentially, possibly in their lifetime. And so when we look at that, when we first came on board, I think the biggest thing we were hearing from agents is that they weren't getting calls back, or they were, you know, there was like some sort of miscommunication that the clients weren't given the contact information at closing for their builder and that sort of thing. So I think we just decided to take it a step further and make sure that no email went unnoticed, no phone call went unanswered. We really made sure that our customers felt like, well, that they knew we cared. And we do care. We always put 110% into every one of our clients, whether they purchased their home 2 years ago or 10 years ago. If they're reaching out to us, we really try to assist them. If they have a realtor, we're fine with that too. We help them because we still are trying to make sure that they're 100% happy with their homes. And that, to us, that's the most important thing. Because we do want them. We want them to love their houses, and that's kind of just, I think, the bare minimum that we could do.
Yeah. With us being a family-owned business, with our husbands running the company and us running the real estate, and the only employees they have are family members, so everyone's family. All of our floor plans are named after family members, and they're based off of their personality.
Yeah, you have to, like, earn one. You don't just get one, either.
With that being said, we feel like the people that are buying our houses are becoming part of our family.
Yeah.
And so we want to be able to reach out to them and let them know we're there. And what we do after closing that I think sets us apart, and again, this is construction, real estate, but it could apply to any
sales. Customer service, yeah.
We still reach out after closing. Yeah. A lot of the time, they're not our clients. Yeah. We represent the builder. We don't represent the buyers. And we still reach out. We bring them pumpkins at Halloween. This was Jamie's thing she came up with. Things at Thanksgiving, Christmas, Valentine's, all these holidays. We're constantly stopping at their house. We drop off a present. And the idea with that is just to let them know we're here. Whether you bought your house 3 years ago, whether you bought it 2 months ago, we're still part of your life. We want you to love your house. We want you to be making happy memories. Our slogan is find your match.
Yeah.
And we want it to be perfect for them. And so we're touching base like that.
I really like it because, you know, when sometimes people think about their real estate agent, they think about like that doctor you go to like, you know, once every 10 years. And I think that's the way a lot of agent behave, and they don't see themselves as a business. Like somebody mentioned it yesterday, and I think it's important. Like I always do this, and I learned about this from some marketing friends. They ask, you know, where's the nearest McDonald's to your house? And I tell them, like, right now it's off of Forest Hill and so on, so on, blah, blah, blah. I'll give my full direction. But they'll say, but why in the world is McDonald's sending ads to your house and retargeting you and also doing TV advertisement? It's because of that constant reminder that we're here. And I love the part that you all bring. It's the service of it as well. It's like, it's the right thing to do. It's kind of like what you're saying. Like, it's the bare minimum that I should be doing as a human being.
And we're really not trying to like, oh, you know, we really want to list your Hildy home if it comes back on the market. We really, truly want the word of mouth. We want them to feel comfortable to come to us if they do have a problem and tell us first. And I mean, it's just that once you have that strong relationship in the community, people trust you, and that just continues to go up. You're always going to go up with
hope
that.
Hope they don't come back to us.
We want them to stay in their house. Yes,
and we just want them to know that we've taken an investment into their lives, and we want them to feel like we are here for them.
Right, and honestly, Hildy homes that go back up on the market sell super quick, and we have people who miss out on them and reach out, and they're like, you know, we really missed out, and you know, and we try to navigate and help them and their agents to figure out another solution. So I think that in itself just speaks a lot for the product that we're putting out there, and I think that just tying it and looping everything back together is very significant for our success. Because sometimes it's the littlest thing that people get the most upset about, and that's something that will stick in their mind forever. Like, can you remember, you know, you think, oh, Hildy forgot to tell us about the mailbox key, so I didn't have a mailbox key for 2 weeks, or whatever, those little things. It's not anything to do with the house, but it's just something little that oftentimes had to do with communication that we see that we have to really just dot our cross our T's and dot our I's on, because it's the little things that matter.
And I think, you know, you gave the example there of what, you know, what could be a challenge. I imagine there are a lot of little things that make a huge impact as well. What are some of those little things that you all do? You mentioned some of the things like birth, you know, delivering stuff and holidays, but are there other little things that maybe agents don't pay attention to that could make a deep impact on the relationship with clients?
I do think it's just learning people's backstory and that communication piece. Even though we're not representing the buyers a lot of times, we want to know what their backstory is. Why are they coming here? Do they have kids? You know, let us know about them. And I think sometimes a lot of agents don't ask those questions. They're so concerned with the sale and wanting to get the sale. And we can't tell you how many times we've told people, we'd love to sell you a house, but I don't think it's the right house for your clients.
We do that.
You know, we want a sale, but I don't think it's the perfect match. And that's a hard conversation to have, especially with newer agents who just, they want a sale too. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they forget that it's more so about finding that perfect thing for their client.
That's the most important thing, is for the client to be happy in their home. And if we went around, you know, just doing the bare minimum and just, or rushing them into a house they can't afford or doesn't have enough bedrooms or whatever, isn't in the right neighborhood, then again, in the end, they're not happy. They don't like their house anymore. You know, it's just not a good situation.
And we're successful because the people we help feel like we care.
Yeah.
And we're transparent and we're honest, because we do get clients. I think we had figured like 15% of our sales, we represent the buyer and the seller. And that's something that for us, it's because we're manning their Facebook page, we're manning their Instagram account, and we're manning their website. So we get those leads, but again, we're very cautious in that, do you have an agent? Like, who is your agent? We ask it multiple times. We ask
honesty,
it in writing. And really, it just goes back to, transparency and honesty and building that trusting relationship that we have to do.
I love what you shared, though, with transparency. I think it's more and more brands nowadays are starting to recognize the importance of that, but it's still yet one of those things that people missed a boat on. I think with transparency, you have a certain level of vulnerability that you have to be willing to give up as well. How do you go about doing that?
You know, I feel like we're both pretty grounded, and we both understand our strengths and our weaknesses. And I think that when you're working with people, the best thing is to be honest. And like I said before, we both came from teaching backgrounds. Mm-hmm. The best feeling ever was to see that look when the kid finally got it. And that's kind of what it feels like when you see a family find their home.
It's
like they found it, and you know. And you're not going to get that for them if you're not being transparent, you're not being honest, and keeping those lines of communication there so that you guys are all on the same page. Because, like she said, one little thing could set things off.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's what people remember oftentimes. And you'll hear that in any customer service industry, like it's the one bad thing, you know, like I think the statistics are you're more likely to remember that one bad thing than all the good things, you know, put together. But I think too, it's also just putting our clients first. And I think that people get so wrapped up in the sale and the glory of that and the money that, you know, you just have to be grounded and go back to, if that
it's
was
about
my
making a difference.
Yeah, it is. And we were put on this earth, I feel like, to do better, to make the world better. And I think her being a teacher, me being a nurse, like that was our ultimate goal. We were always wanting to help people. And so now we're just applying that to the real estate market.
Yeah.
And honestly, it's basic customer service. I go back to, I worked a lot of different jobs during college, in high school, that were customer service driven. And I honestly use all of those skills in selling real estate. I mean, I don't want to talk about my telemarketing days, but I was taught a lot of sales things that maybe weren't the best.
Yeah.
But, you know, then I worked for a family-owned department store, and they were really customer service driven. And I think that I still think about those philosophies, you know.
Yeah, I'm of the notion of like this, that we are as, that go back to the educational concept that you all mentioned in the discussion there. Both come with an education mindset, and you said this about twice so far in the conversation. I feel that usually people who come with that type of idea to the table, you're one, you have a sense of curiosity, which enable to have a better conversation. And then also you have more empathy typically than a salesperson who is just trying to get the sale, because that gives you, I guess, added investment in it. I don't know. I think it, you're vested in this person's ultimate success. So looking at this, and we know money's not the most important thing in the world, but it's right up there with oxygen.
Yeah.
It's up there with oxygen.
You need it.
It's still pretty important.
How has that service mindset led to your financial success as an organization?
I would say we wouldn't be remotely as successful if we didn't have this mindset. Our husbands have had a very successful company. They had other agents who didn't necessarily have the same mindset that we do. We eat, breathe, sleep our job, and we care, and we all care. And I think that that is what has made us successful. I think that before us, they were successful, but that heart wasn't there, and that makes a difference.
And honestly, I think people think we were just handed this opportunity, the opportunity that we have, but we really were given it, given a trial basis in one of their small markets where we were still working our full-time jobs for 18 months. And like, I was running a nursing program. She was with students 8 hours a day, and we still were able to maintain. And, you know, it took a lot of discipline and a lot of time and just a lot of, you know, learning the ropes by fire, I guess. You know, you were
trial
just kind of thrown
fire.
Into it, trial by fire. And we had to prove that we were ready to do this. Like, and honestly, we had to prove ourselves to our husbands that we could
be fired any day.
I know, yeah. And that's how they are. They are very like, this is our business. We are going to have this business, and it's going to be successful. We hope that this is going to work out, but you guys need to do what we're saying, stay on our Abe game. And, you know, we kind of were the bosses in our own jobs, if you think about it. Like, Nicole's an autonomous, and so am I. So we were used to driving our own ship, and then all of a sudden, our husbands are our bosses. And we're like, okay, you know? And it's like, okay, how are we going to approach this? And so, yeah, I think, again, a lot of self-discipline and a lot of work.
I think success is learning.
I think you're going to fail,
and I think that it's constantly a learning experience. We learn new things every day.
And real estate.
How you handle those.
Yeah. And, you know, with technology advancing, real estate, the customer service aspect, all of that is constantly evolving. And no transition or no transaction or customer is exactly alike. And so, yeah, I think we have to be really flexible.
There's a couple questions I have going back to the idea of the family side. How do you ensure, because you hear people say, don't do business with family. You guys went all in with family. You got two businesses, two with family, and everything. The whole family is a part of it. The business, the floor plans are named after family. How do you ensure that you still maintain your strong family ties, still working together and with the business?
You know, I think I would say, especially, I'll give the guys' parents a lot of credit.
Mm-hmm.
They made it very clear when they were young. You two have each other. You're always together. Family is first.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have a lot growing up, and they were taught they had to work to have it. And their grandma, who passed away a couple years ago, was very adamant that you two stay together, stay with family. No matter how successful you get, that's what's first. And so we have moments where Jamie and I are very opposite.
Mm-hmm.
We're polar opposites.
Yes.
We have moments where we're not on the same page.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the guys will have moments where they're not. And we'll have to sit down and have a powwow and, you know, be like, we're going to get through this. And we do.
Yeah.
And then we move on. And
we do.
Everybody in the family, I feel like I have four kids. She has four kids, even though we only have two each. It's family.
Yeah,
and it is how it is, and there is no other option.
Right.
Yeah.
At the end of the day,
understand that we work hard. We work at all hours of the day. But if they need us, we had volleyball tournaments all weekend. They were taking our other daughter to basketball. We were going to volleyball. We drop and we do it, but then it's work time.
And we definitely have each other's back, so that if I know she's at a volleyball tournament, that means a lot. I try to take calls. Even though we're co-listing everything, we each have a point person on each house. So, like, I'm the primary on half of them. She's the primary on half of them. But I'll take over for her when need be. And because we want to be able to do have our lives outside of our job. And I think we've gotten more disciplined with that. And that's something, you know, you have to tell clients no too, because in this world, people want instant, I don't want to say instant gratification, but it is that. It's instant responses. It's instant text backs. And you really have to set boundaries with your clients and say, hey, you know, I'm not going to answer your email and text at 10 o'clock at night. You know, I always think nobody's dying. The nurse in me is like, okay, I'm not a trauma surgeon, so I don't need to be on call with real estate unless there's a flood or something, you know, major.
For any new agent or any new person in sales, that's something really important for them to understand. You need to have boundaries, mm-hmm. and you need to stick with them.
And I mean, you can be friends with them, or, you know, you can be... I don't know how to say this. I had to learn this really quick. I mean, you can have camaraderie with your clients, but at the end of the day, you still have a business relationship. And I think that that's just a fine line too, in maintaining professionalism with them. That's just, I mean, it goes back to customer service too.
No,
they're still your customer. And
I absolutely love that idea, and the principles that you teach there, because I made the mistake early on where I was that sales rep that was bending over backwards and going, doing things that were outside of, I didn't need to do, and it caused me to get freaked out and stressed out and worried and mess up my peace of mind and my family, you know, life. And you gotta be able to have those, set the parameters. And I love that. I think it's important for those new sellers to understand that.
I think anybody new in sales needs to remember that they have to have self-care, and they have to take care of themselves before you can take care of others. And so it's kind of like, just, you know, remember that. Like,
sure.
Try to get your workout in. Try to eat lunch, even when you have crazy days.
Lunch? What's that?
I don't miss my workout.
Yeah, she never misses her workout. And we kind of know each other. I think that's the convenience, too, of us being next door and kind of know what we're doing, you know? And it just makes it so much easier for us and our clients, because also, like, we are able to get answers quicker. But we try to get back to realtors too in a really, you know, in a pretty quick time frame, just because we know that they have clients on the other end waiting for an answer.
So I would say with anyone new in sales also, know your product.
You know what you're doing. We've said that over and over.
If you sound incompetent, no one's going to believe you.
Right. Somebody said that, and it was always something I used in nursing school. But of course, patient safety came first, but fake it till you make it. And I would tell a new realtor, be that way. Don't tell people, and I'm bad at this, this is my first house I've sold. This is my first, because in any job, you just have to go with it, walk in with confidence. And honestly, if you are that insecure about it, you need to educate yourself more, because clients are going to pick up on that, and then they're going to say, oh, she or he has no idea what they're doing. And, you know, and you just don't want that. It goes, again, back to customer service.
The more you know your product, the more you understand your business, the better you can help your clients. That's what I'm picking up on that. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's say that we're looking in a camera, and let's go with you first, Nicole. Like, you are talking to your 18-year-old self. What advice would you give yourself way back then?
Set high standards for yourself. Have a plan. Work hard. Don't be afraid to fail, because you learn from failure. Things are not always going to be easy, but with hard work, you're going to get through. And success doesn't come easy. That's probably about it.
Okay, how about you, Jamie?
I would say, you know, looking back, like, work hard. You know you're going to work hard. And I think when I was 18, if you would have told me that I was going to become a realtor, I would have never believed it. Like, I have my doctorate in education. Like, I went to school for 1,000 years. But I tell you what, I still think that I needed to go through all that journey to get to where I am today. And so it's like, don't give up. Don't give up on your dreams, because I wanted to own my own business even back when I was like 21. I just didn't know what it was going to be, you know? And it was like, we couldn't all own our own businesses. Somebody had to hold the health insurance. Somebody had to have a guaranteed job. And as our husbands were, you know, we were in the back burner helping them, but as they were growing their business, we were a big part of that from the very beginning, but we always wanted something to call our own. And I think we both kind of were like, you know, because we missed stuff. Our husbands were, we just didn't have any flexibility in our schedules. So I think just don't give up on that. don't give up on your dreams originally, because eventually they'll pan out, I think.
I love it. If folks out there listening to this episode want to get in touch with you all, what's the best way for them to go about doing so?
You know, email or our website, refinedrealtygroupnebraska.com. Our email address is Nicole.Hilderbrand@betteromaha.com.
Mine's Jamie.Hilderbrand, H-I-L-D-E-R-B-R-A-N-D @betteromaha.com. So definitely reach out. Find us on social media.
Check out Realty Homes website.
Yeah, we do a lot of stuff on social media, and we like to share our story and just help you find a new house if you moved to Nebraska. You can be next.
Yeah, there you go. They're good salespeople, y'all. Thank you all so much.
Thank you
for having us.
Well, that was so much fun, and that was such a treat. I'm so jealous that I couldn't be there with Donald and Nicole and Jamie. That was awesome.
It was awesome.
Coming from someone who worked a lot of customer service, like in high school and in college, I think it's really, really cool that they pay such close attention to detail with all of your clients. And at the end of the day, I think that makes such a huge difference. Coming from someone who worked customer service, but also from a customer's perspective too. I think those are the things that you remember and makes you want to go back.
I just love the creativity. And like you said, the attention to detail, like details, like they're just like super creative. And I feel like that stuff can apply. And it doesn't matter if you're going into business or entrepreneurship or not, like just a simple fact that you can, you know, take, you know, give a really thoughtful gift to a family member or a friend or whatnot. It was really cool. So you can make your life so much better by helping other people make their life better.
Again, I'm so glad that you got to talk to them. If you want to connect with Nicole and Jamie, you can go ahead and find all their information in the show notes. And if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe. You can find us everywhere where you can find a podcast. We will be there. We're on Apple and Google and Stitcher. So until next time.
Be better.